This afternoon's presentation is a paper called Clarence X, the Black Nationalist Behind Justice Thomas's Originalism. It was written by Professor Stephen Smith at University of Virginia. Unfortunately, Stephen Smith's aeroplane could not take off today because there's lots of snow everywhere. So in his place again, we're thankful to have Professor Pildes return to present the paper. And then we will have commentary by Professor Jeffrey Rosen from George Washington and Professor Deborah Malamud from NYU. So I won't say anything else, and Professor Pildes can take it away.
Well, this is certainly going to be one of the more unusual roles I've played in my academic career. So this morning I played myself initially as an introducer of the symposium, and then I played Sai Prakash, who couldn't make it out here and commenting on Nicole's paper, but now I'm going to channel Stephen Smith to present this paper. But Dan and I talked a little bit about what to do when Stephen couldn't get up here today because of the weather. And I thought it was extremely important to try to have for you at least some sense of the argument and the analysis in this paper, because I think, speaking as myself now, I think this is an extremely interesting paper, one of the more interesting things that has been written on Justice Thomas, not just for this symposium, but in general. And it's really unfortunate that Stephen couldn't be here to present it himself, because it would be far, far more powerful coming from him than it is from me. Stephen was a law clerk to Justice Thomas. And the paper is titled, as Dan said, Clarence X, which is already a provocative way to start, because as you'll see, the point of the paper in part is to suggest various links between the thinking of Malcolm X and the thinking of Justice Thomas. So it's Clarence X, the Black Nationalist behind Justice Thomas's constitutionalism. Okay, so let me try to, without reading the paper, which would take too long, try to give you the core ideas in the paper and some of the examples that Professor Smith uses here. Part of what he wants to say is that Justice Thomas has a jurisprudence that is both uniquely his own, which is not appreciated, and uniquely among conservative constitutionalists and conservative justices on the court, a unique kind of constitutional or political conservatism, and that it's a distinctly Black conservative voice that Justice Thomas brings to his work as a Supreme Court justice. So that while Justice Thomas is known for his originalism and his textualism, which is a set of judicial philosophies about the Constitution shared by other, at least some other, current conservative justices on the court, he is just as importantly someone who ought to be known for what Professor Smith calls Justice Thomas's Black nationalism. And Professor Smith says, or points out, that Justice Thomas has explored the implication of major Supreme Court decisions specifically for Black Americans, partly in the way that Professor Garnett talked about this morning, and often in cases that don't obviously or immediately involve issues of race. That is, they're not race-based cases about affirmative action or peremptory strikes in jury cases. They may be cases like school vouchers. They may be cases like anti-gang loitering ordinance kinds of issues and other sorts of cases. And what Professor Smith says, actually we'll start calling him Stephen now, make it a little shorter, is that it's particularly noteworthy that Justice Thomas almost always seeks to justify his positions in cases that explicitly involve race, not just in terms of originalism or textualism, but in terms of how these cases affect the interests of Black Americans, and to show that the positions he takes, in his view, actually better serve the interests of Black Americans. Stephen points out that Malcolm X is explicitly and self-consciously one of the people that Justice Thomas talks about as having been very influential over him, in fact, having been one of his personal heroes. And I guess this is me speaking for a second. If you've read Justice Thomas's autobiography, and I encourage you to read it, if you haven't, you will see how much of a struggle Justice Thomas has gone through over the course of his life in trying to decide what his relationship is to various issues, including the issues that Malcolm X put prominently on the agenda during the 1960s and 1970s. Now, when people hear the language black nationalism, Professor Smith recognizes that they often associate that with a particular view of what it means, a view that Malcolm X himself did have at certain points in his life, but a view that is not part of what Stephen sees as Justice Thomas's view, but I think it's important to express that view, as Stephen does in the paper, before turning to what he means to emphasize. Black nationalism here doesn't mean a view that whites will always be hostile to the interests of blacks. It doesn't mean a view that blacks should sort of withdraw themselves and focus on developing their own nations, perhaps. A view of black nationalism that did exist in U.S. black political debates up until the 1920s or so, but then became much less prominent after that time. Instead, the strand of black nationalism in Malcolm X's thinking that Stephen says links up to Justice Thomas's thought has to do with issues of self-help, self-determination. As he says, even in the face of modern white racism, black nationalists contend blacks can succeed by getting a good education, avoiding self-defeating behavior like substance addiction and crime, forming stable family structures, creating economic opportunities for themselves, by self-consciously investing in themselves and their own communities. And then Stephen uses this quote from Malcolm X to provide some window into Justice Thomas's thought in some of the cases and contexts that we've talked about earlier today. You'll hear some resonance in what we talked about this morning in this quote, although the quote is much put in much more forceful terms for Malcolm X. But this is Malcolm X speaking. Politically, the American Negro is nothing but a football, and the white liberals control this mentally dead ball through tricks of tokenism, false promises of integration and civil rights. In this profitable game of deceiving and exploiting the politics of the American Negro, those white liberals have the willing cooperation of the Negro civil rights leaders. These leaders sell out our people for just a few crumbs of token recognition and token gains. These leaders are satisfied with token victories and token progress because they themselves are nothing but token leaders. Stephen goes on to start drawing the links between these strands in Malcolm X's thought, in his view, in Stephen's view, and Justice Thomas. Like Malcolm X, I'm now reading from the paper, Justice Thomas discovered that black progress was not something to be despaired of in America, nor something to be conferred by white society in its beneficence. Instead, the proper lesson to be drawn from Malcolm X was that the black community itself has the keys to its own progress. By becoming self-reliant and self-sufficient, blacks can succeed regardless of how whites might feel about them. Having laid that sort of initial framework of ideas, Professor Smith goes on to begin the process of trying to show how these ideas play out in Justice Thomas's decisions. And at this stage, he brings up three particular cases where Thomas wrote for himself and where some strands of these kinds of ideas are reflected. Now, one of those is the issue about the Fordyce case and school integration and the value of black institutions and the concerns he's expressed about jurisprudence, which diminishes the value, the significance of black educational institutions. And we talked about that a fair amount this morning. So let me mention the other two examples that are unique to this paper. The first is a case called Dawson versus Delaware, involving a white man who was charged with capital murder and who sought to avoid the death penalty by showing that, as Judge Smith was talking about this morning, that he had mitigating factors that argued in favor of his character being good enough to justify his not receiving a death sentence, even given the acts for which he had been convicted. In prison, he had become a member of the Aryan Brotherhood, and the prosecutors sought to rebut this evidence by introducing evidence of what the Aryan Brotherhood was and what it meant to be a member of a prison gang involving the Aryan Brotherhood. This is a white supremacist, violent organization. And the Supreme Court held that it was unconstitutional to admit this evidence because this was a kind of associational set of beliefs. And even though all the evidence of arguable relevance to proving good character could come in, this evidence to prove bad character was not admissible. Justice Thomas wrote a separate opinion. He was the lone dissenter in the case, and he argued that the Aryan Brotherhood, this is now quoting from Justice Thomas, does not exist merely to facilitate formulation of abstract racist thought, but to respond to gangs of racial minorities. The Aryan Brotherhood, he notes, is a singularly vicious prison gang that has a hostility to black inmates that originated in the prison violence of the 1960s. And Justice Thomas goes on to argue that in a jurisprudence in which the state is obligated to admit any evidence that goes towards mitigation of a death sentence in terms of showing positive character of the defendant, this kind of evidence should have been admissible on the other side of the coin. So that's one distinctive opinion, Justice Thomas writing for himself. A second, which we haven't talked about so far, is Justice Thomas's writing in the cross-burning case, Virginia versus Black. And as Professor Smith points out, this is the case where Justice Thomas vigorously asked a number of questions at the oral argument in contrast to his usual silence at the oral arguments, a case of the burning of a cross on the grounds of a private family in Virginia. And Justice Thomas, viewing cross-burning as such an inherently intimidating and violent act based on the history of cross-burning in the United States and what it means, was unwilling to recognize cross-burning as constitutionally protected speech, unlike the rest of the court. He wrote, cross-burning has almost invariably meant lawlessness and understandably instills in its victims well-grounded fears of physical violence. Cross-burning is simply a physical threat. He quotes from a black mother who had endured a cross-burning in front of her house. After the mother saw the burning cross, she was crying on her knees in the living room. She felt feelings of frustration and intimidation and feared for her husband's life. She testified what the burning cross symbolized to her as a black American. This is all quoted in Justice Thomas's opinion. Nothing good, murder, hanging, rape, lynching, just anything bad that could happen to a person. So along with the Fordyce case and the issues about integration in the schools, Professor Smith offers these as examples of Justice Thomas writing in a voice that is very attuned to concerns of at least some portions of the black community, not in any way shying away from such issues, but actually bringing those issues into the court's cases. Thomas quotes frequently from W.E.B. Du Bois. In fact, in the cases defending black educational institutions that are not the product of de jure segregation through law by the state, but that have arisen in response to segregation and continue to exist in the present. Du Bois' line, we must rally to the defense of our schools. The paper is clearly still in the process of being developed, and there are placeholders for a variety of other issues, including voting rights that Professor Smith is going to explore, in which he sees Justice Thomas speaking from a perspective that he associates with this black nationalism element in Thomas's thought. Smith notes that no other justice joined Justice Thomas in any of these opinions, the ones he's focused on so far, and he says, to borrow a phrase from Malcolm X, perhaps these opinions were too black, too strong for other justices to join. And part of the reason Smith writes this is in response to this very poignant line that he quotes from Justice Thomas when Justice Thomas was giving a speech in 1998 to the National Bar Association, which is an association of black lawyers. Thomas said, "It pains me deeply, more deeply than any of you can imagine, to be perceived by so many members of my race as doing them harm. All the sacrifice, all the long hours of preparation were to help, that is, to help the black community, not to hurt." And what Smith says is that all of this about Justice Thomas is too easily dismissed by his critics, that when Justice Thomas rejects the broad use of traditional civil rights remedies, he gives arguments for rejecting those remedies that Professor Smith calls black nationalist arguments, along the lines of some of the strains from Malcolm X that I quoted. As to some extent, I think Professor Garnett was saying this morning, Professor Smith says, Justice Thomas's view is that these remedies, though presented as necessary to the well-being of the black community, actually serve to undermine the interests of blacks. Properly understood, Justice Thomas contends that traditional civil rights remedies are too limited and not radical enough to produce meaningful gains for the black community. Okay, then Professor Smith's paper closes by asking the question, well, if these are some of the influences of on Thomas, if these are some of the manifestations of that influence in his opinions, if he does bring a distinctively black conservative voice to his judicial conservatism, how can all that be reconciled with being a constitutional judge, obligated to follow the American Constitution, constrained in certain sorts of ways, not to do what one's political vision might suggest, but to apply the Constitution? And at this point, Professor Smith goes on to argue that I think, if I understand this part of the argument correctly, both that the Constitution is open-ended enough to entail the possibilities that Justice, or permit the possibilities that Justice Thomas is pursuing in these cases, and that the kind of colorblindness vision that informs some of Justice Thomas's views is, of course, traceable to a plausible strand in American constitutional history, whatever one thinks about the underlying debate. So maybe I should close by reading from some of the conclusion, so you get the sense of how Professor Smith concludes this inquiry. If, as the title of this symposium suggests, important aspects of the jurisprudence of Justice Thomas remain unknown, after almost two decades, it is because his critics choose to mischaracterize his votes and to stifle debate on matters of importance to the black community. Far from manifesting indifference or hostility to the interests of black Americans, Thomas's opinions reveal a justice who is intensely, perhaps even obsessively, concerned with the progress of black America, and who passionately believes that the path to progress, now that non-discrimination is the law of the land, lies in self-reliance and self-improvement. this emphasis on blacks improving their own plight instead of relying on others places Thomas squarely in a long line of black nationalists that includes the now beloved icon of Malcolm X, who had his own well-publicized difficulties with the civil rights leadership during the 1960s and was regarded as a dangerous radical. Thomas, like his critics and his supporters, may or may not be right on the merits. Indeed, there may not be any one right answer on an issue as complex as how best to advance a race comprised of tens of millions of people from all different walks of life. It is clear, however, that the issues of racial It is clear, however, that right or wrong, Justice Thomas has spoken as eloquently and passionately as anyone else about the issues of racial justice that have come before the Supreme Court during his tenure. This has made for a distinctive brand of conservative jurisprudence that is infused with black nationalism and interesting reading for those of us who have the privilege of following the court's handiwork for a living. With any luck, Thomas's most strident critics will stop hurling accusations and epithets about his opinions and start reading them. If they do, maybe we can finally have an honest, respectful debate both within the black community and the nation at large about uncomfortable but pressing issues of racial justice. What is more, maybe after 20 years, they will finally recognize Justice Thomas for what he really is. He is neither knave nor fool, least of all any sort of traitor, in quotes, to his race. He is quite simply Clarence X, a black man who has a surprising amount in common with another black man, another notable black man who went by the initial X. Okay, that's all Justice, that's all Professor Smith. I'm not sure if we picked an order.
Yes,
but
we did.
Okay, very well. On to whoever is the first commentator on Professor Smith's paper.
It is I.
Ah, so Jeff Rosen.
Well, I was delighted to get an invitation to comment on Stephen Smith's paper. I'm a big fan of Steve Smith's, whom I met in the mid-1990s when I was writing an article on Justice Thomas for The New Yorker. And Stephen Smith helped me to understand Thomas in a light that at the time was not on the radar screen, but is reflected in this paper, namely the strongest strains of Thomas's black nationalism. And at Smith's suggestion, I watched the videotapes where Justice Thomas would go to black colleges and give inspirational speeches of black uplift, quoting W.E.B. Du Bois, and in memorable tones, identifying with the audience by saying, "Some of you are poor and never had money to buy shoes. I was there. Some of you were degraded and victims of racism. I was there." Very strong stuff. And this piece, largely inspired by my conversations with Steve Smith, recognized this nationalist aspect of Thomas's commitments. I also agree very strongly with the paper that Thomas continues to be unfairly caricatured on several levels. Many blacks still view him as an Uncle Tom for his conservative views about affirmative action. There's that dreadful line from the rapper KRS-One, "The white man ain't the devil, I promise. You want to see the devil, take a look at Clarence Thomas." And at the same time, many white liberals continue to accept the condescending and arguably racist stereotypes of him as an intellectual lightweight who takes marching orders from his ideological master, Antonin Scalia. And Stephen Smith, like other sophisticated critics, convinces us that neither of these two stereotypes has any basis in reality. In the spirit of the conference, though, I'm going to try to raise two objections to the paper. Stephen Smith argues, first of all, that Thomas's nationalism is completely consistent with his commitment to originalism. And secondly, he argues that he's a consistent nationalist in the Malcolm X tradition dedicated to black self-help and black uplift. And I want to argue that both of those claims are unconvincing, that in fact, Thomas's distinctive brand of nationalism is impossible to reconcile with the original understanding of the 14th Amendment, whose framers explicitly rejected the sweeping vision of colorblindness that Thomas embraces. And second, that calling Clarence X doesn't quite capture the distinctive and unusual vision of nationalism that Thomas embraces. I think Thomas's memoir reveals him, inadvertently or not, a little bit more specifically as an emotionalist and populist who is consumed with hatred at elites, not only white elites, but also the light-skinned black elites that he viewed snubbed him in law school and opposed his confirmation, and that this populism, more than a commitment to black uplift and self-help for its own sake, may capture his nationalism a little more specifically. All right, so those are the two points. Let me try to put them on the table. The originalism, I don't mean to, this is not a conference on originalism, I don't mean to bore you with the details of why I think Thomas's race opinions are unoriginalist in the extreme. I just want to argue very briefly that it's remarkable that Thomas, after nearly 20 years on the bench, has continued to fail to cite the overwhelming consensus among liberal and conservative legal historians of Reconstruction. That's impossible to reconcile with his vision. Thomas is basically a Korematsu man. That's the heart of the Grutter dissent. He quotes Korematsu saying, only pressing public necessity can justify racial discrimination, as he puts it, quoting Justice Black. And Thomas says, in my view, nothing short of a threat rising to an imminent threat to life and limb. I conclude that only those measures the state must take to provide a bulwark against anarchy or to prevent violence will constitute a pressing public necessity. So he's taken the modern conception of equal protection in Korematsu and ratcheted it up in a very distinctive and rather unprecedented way that's uniquely his own. This has nothing to do with the vision of the framers of the 14th Amendment, which, don't take my word for it, let's just use the scholarship of the most respected conservative scholar of Reconstruction, Michael McConnell, now a judge on the 10th Circuit, as well as Earl Maltz and other experts in this area, recognized was one of Libinid absolute equality. So Smith says, well, whatever you think of Thomas's vision, it's not completely impossible to locate in the text, history, and structure of the amendment. And he quotes Justice Harlan's dissent in Plessy. Of course, it's not completely impossible to locate, but it is impossible for a specific originalist, as Thomas claims to be, because it was not a commitment to colorblindness in general that animated the framers, but a commitment to colorblindness with regard to civil rights, but not political and social rights. Moreover, the framers of the Reconstruction Amendments had a pretty precise understanding of what those civil rights were. The core of them were the rights enumerated in the Civil Rights Act of 1866, the right to make and enforce contracts, to sue and be sued, to inherit property. They did not include at the time, or would not have included, most of the rights that are at issue in Thomas's most famous race opinion. So voting rights, Thomas is very strong in cases like Miller and Bush and Vera, that any race-conscious drawing of voting districts for the benefit of minority violates the Equal Protection Clause. The framers would have thought that political rights aren't covered by the Equal Protection Clause at all, as this is an overdetermined point. Affirmative action and federal contracting, the Adirond case, where Thomas is so vehement about the dangers of racial classification. I think it's fair to say they didn't think too much about public works because there wasn't much of a regulatory state, but they would have understood the right to build highways as one in which the government was acting like a private contractor, an at-will employer, free to discriminate against or in favor of anyone that it pleased. And education, amazing that Thomas hasn't cited McConnell's path-breaking article on originalism and the desegregation decisions more explicitly. But as McConnell acknowledges, the Reconstruction Congress, the 39th Congress, almost certainly did not believe that education was a civil right. You could make a case that shifting majorities in the 1875 Congress thought so, but that's not really a argument that should be open to the kind of originalist that Thomas usually claims to be. And even if education were a civil right, you still have to make a case about why racial classifications with respect to it are caste-affirming. Thomas just asserts that the stigma of affirmative action is equivalent to that of slavery, but there's no evidence that the framers shared that view, as Schnapper's work on the Freedmen's Bureau shows. So it's just, yes, it's not completely implausible, but it's not, doesn't begin to meet the standard that Thomas holds other constitutional arguments to in the Commerce Clause cases, for example, or the Non-Delegation Clause. He's a more specific originalist than Scalia, as Smith notes, willing to overturn in a moment precedents that he thinks are inconsistent with original understanding, no reason that he shouldn't revisit Korematsu with its far broader ban on all racial classifications if the original understanding pointed in the opposite direction. So that's all I'll say on this, except that I just find it frustrating, because this is not, there are many contested areas of historical understanding. This is one that's been very well plowed, and there's a lot of consensus among liberals and conservatives, and Thomas has just ignored it. He has completely ignored the historical evidence on the issue, which is central to the constitutional questions that he cares most about. And for myself, it's made it harder for me to take him seriously as a committed originalist. All right, that's the first point. The second point is my thought that Malcolm X and W.E.B. Du Bois are not the extent of Thomas's commitment to black nationalism. You certainly get elements of black uplift in his opinions. I think his most powerful opinion is the Grutter dissent, with that remarkable, searing opening quotation from Frederick Douglass: "Do nothing with us. Your doing with us has already played the mischief with us. Do nothing with us." Just an extraordinary piece of writing, and very much in the Du Bois Malcolm tradition. I have to say, again, I may be alone in this reaction, I respected the dissent less and found it less consistent with Malcolm X and W.E.B. Du Bois after reading Thomas's memoir. Because in the memoir, Thomas reveals himself more candidly, more nakedly, than any justice since William O. Douglas, whose memoir at the end of his judicial career was similarly raw in its revelations. There are a lot of similarities between Douglas and Thomas, as their memoirs show. Both had fraught relationships with relatives who expressed doubt about whether they were good enough to succeed. Both had emotionally torturous childhoods, which created in both of them a burning sense of anger, insecurity, and sense of class resentment, which they expressed by railing against the institutions that failed to recognize their worth. In Douglas, it was the establishment. Thomas, the man to some degree, but it's not just the white man, because the core of his anger, you learn from the memoir, is directed not primarily or even exclusively to whites, but to the black and white elites who have conspired against him, he thinks, for his entire life. In the memoir, he writes, "Many light-skinned blacks believe themselves to be superior to their darker brethren, an attitude that struck me as not much different than white racism." He told a law clerk for another justice how rejected and shunned he felt by his black Yale classmates, the pretty people, he called them, many of whom would later oppose his nomination to the Supreme Court. Light-skinned blacks, he says, were his enemies because they never viewed him as an equal, unlike the real grassroots black people who treated him well. What distressed me about learning this from the memoir is, for me, it undermined both the principled colorblindness and also the W.E.B. Du Bois, Malcolm-like nationalism inherent in the Grutter opinion. Suddenly, when you understand his hatred of the black elites, you understand, first of all, his hatred of Yale Law School, which is palpable in the memoir. He just repeatedly talks about how much he hates it. He took his diploma and hung it upside down in the basement and put a Chiquita banana sticker on it because he thought it was so worthless, filled with anger for Yale. But also you understand an aspect of the Grutter dissent, which Stephen, who I know means to write about Grutter, hasn't had a chance to yet in this draft. I hope he'll address this. The populism and hatred of elitism is palpable throughout the decision. Thomas talks about the faddish slogans of the cognoscente, who think that Michigan has a compelling interest in sustaining an elite public university. He says, why does Michigan need a public university if it doesn't want to have, it's very easy for it to avoid racial preferences without affirmative action. All it has to do is have a lottery, as Texas did after the state legislature banned affirmative action and the legislature instituted a 10% program requiring the admission of anyone from the top 10% of Texas high schools. The effect of the Texas 10% plan was to destroy the University of Texas at the undergrad level as a selective university. Professors complained about having to give remedial classes as a result. And Justice O'Connor, in her majority opinion in Grutter, was clearly moved by the idea that the state shouldn't have to choose between accepting public funds and abandoning academic standards, that given the strong pressures that she recognized to keep up some degree of racial diversity, she knew there'd be these political pressures to adjust by canning the standards entirely, and she felt that the more measured alternative of affirmative action was constitutional because there was a compelling interest in educational excellence. And Thomas will just have none of it. He hates the idea of state-funded elitism if the cost is a compromise of colorblindness, and I think this is really the core of his Grutter dissent. All right, so you have these two visions, say these two policy visions of affirmative action. On the one hand, O'Connor, who sees affirmative action as a less dramatic compromise of standards than the elimination of standards that's sure to follow a colorblindness mandate, and Thomas, who says you got to choose no race consciousness, but you can just can the standards entirely. How does the Constitution adjudicate among them? It doesn't very clearly, according to the standards Thomas's embrace. I mean, the anti-caste principle, which was at the core of the Reconstruction vision, doesn't really tell you what to do with these two ideas. My instinct would be, if there's some dispute about whether or not a classification is caste affirming, you defer to the legislature in the face of uncertainty, if you're a judicial restraint guy, as Thomas claims to be in other circumstances, but he doesn't really engage that. There is one strand of the constitutional tradition that is more consistent with Thomas's vision of nationalism, his populism and hatred of elitism, than the Malcolm X strand, and that is the Jacksonian hatred of class legislation leading up to Lochner. So throughout the 19th century, courts were very comfortable striking down special interest laws that favored one group of economic competitors over another on the grounds that it was a form of special pleading. And this prohibition on class legislation culminated in Lochner and went out of fashion afterward because of the story that we much know. It seems to me that the most distinctive contribution that Thomas will make in the long term is not necessarily his race jurisprudence, although the decisions are very memorable, but he's more unique in the fact that he alone on the Roberts Court is willing to embrace a populist pre-New Deal understanding of federal power. So in cases like Raich and Lopez, he's the only vote the libertarians have for the possibility of striking down the New Deal and resurrecting these pre-New Deal understandings of limited federal power. This is consistent with a Lochnerian sympathy. I think it'll be his long-term legacy. And I wonder whether, Rick and I were just talking about this, tossing around the idea before the panel started, whether Thomas might be more willing to be an open Lochnerian, which is what he really is, striking down class legislation and also enforcing libertarian rights not only in the economic sphere but also in the moral sphere, if not for the specter of Roe. I mean, he was shaped enough by the conservative legal movement to think he was supposed to be suspicious of unenumerated rights and substantive due process because of the wages of Roe, but you see in all sorts of opinions, I know you were talking about this morning, his impulse to join in Lawrence, his privacy opinions, his work with Ken Masugi before he joined the bench. These are strands of libertarianism which he might feel more comfortable expressing openly were it not for this fear of substantive process. But be that as it may, I am convinced that the only way you can really get to where Thomas wants to go, back to affirmative action, striking down preferences for one group over another, is really to resurrect the shadow of Lochnerism and embrace openly a pre-New Deal conception of the 14th Amendment, and that's the one thing he's not willing to do. So I leave with the thought that Stephen Smith is absolutely right to remind us that Thomas deserves great respect for the uniqueness, the passion, the individualism of his views, but the one thing that those views cannot be reconciled with is a general commitment to neutrality, judicial restraint, originalism, or suppressing your personal preference in case after case. Thank you so much.
Professor Deborah Malamud.
Yes, you might notice I am not Professor Christina Rodriguez. I'm a late substitution here. I sort of found myself a number of years ago in the same situation Professor Smith is in his participation in this volume, in that He is 16 years past his clerkship for Justice Thomas and is writing about the justice's race jurisprudence. It so happens that about 12 years after my clerkship with Justice Blackmun, I was asked by a group of former Blackmun clerks who were publishing what we hoped would be a celebration of the justice while he lived, unfortunately, became a posthumous festschrift, to take on the assignment of evaluating Justice Blackmun's race jurisprudence. And Justice Blackmun's race jurisprudence, needless to say, is quite different from Justice Thomas's. But in the circles in which most Blackmun clerks were traveling at the time, was a problematic race jurisprudence for not having been consistently liberal enough to satisfy the Blackmun clerkdom as it convened in 1998, which was the year that I wrote The Police. And largely, the complaint about Justice Blackmun was that he had only late in his career started speaking about the issue of race with the kind of preacherly rhetorical strength that was manifest in his rejection of the death penalty, in his accusation of canneries as running a plantation system, et cetera, et cetera. And product of the University of Chicago that I am, I tend to be somewhat less strident in my sense of what it means to have a responsible jurisprudence in any area, and I think that jurisprudence can't be solely judged on the basis of that kind of passionate voice. And so what I mainly want to do is turn back to some criteria that I created for myself for the purpose of really, as best as I could, disinterestedly evaluating Justice Blackmun's race jurisprudence as such, not just simply his voice on racial questions. And so that's going to be what I'm going to do with most of my commentary time. I do want to just say at the beginning that I don't write pieces with zingy titles, and that's really a problem. And so I get to confess that Clarence X doesn't really quite cut it for me. I'm all about nuance, and unfortunately, and so is Steve, really. But unfortunately, the concept of black self-help has appeared in views within the African American community that run across the board from the radical confrontational version that I associate with Malcolm X to the conservative and accommodationist version that I associate with Booker T. Washington. Self-help is definitely a strong theme in the justice's work, but I don't really see black nationalism in the fuller sense of the seeking for black exercise of power as really a part of the justice's jurisprudence. But I do think that it's a fascinating race jurisprudence and one that deserves the kind of close look that this conference is giving it. So here's what I said before, and as I say, I invented this for my justice, so this is as neutral as an exercise can be in identifying the key elements of a race jurisprudence. As I said, the speaking with a passionate voice on the issue of race is only one part of a race jurisprudence. Here are some other things I identified, and I will then come back and talk about each one in relation to Justice Thomas's race jurisprudence. The first, and what I identified as potentially the most important ingredient of a race jurisprudence, is its scope, in the sense of what does the jurisprudence recognize as a race issue. And I understand that it was the emphasis of some of the work discussed this morning that Justice Thomas, in fact, sees race where race may not be obvious to the average justice or legal analyst. That's an example of what I would mean there. Another very important marker of a race jurisprudence is its sense of time. And what I meant by that then is am reading, where does the justice place the present day in the timeline of the transition from slavery to racial equality? What is an acceptable rate of progress in achieving racial equality? Race jurisprudence is also defined, and we've been talking about this to some extent, by what I called its degree of focus on race and on racial consequences when the issue of race comes up associated with other areas of legal doctrine that to which the justice may have independently strong commitments. And I'll talk about that in this case as well. Another element of a race jurisprudence was what I identified as a sense of method. Can society trust judges to know racism when they see it? If not, how can they be taught to see it? In that sense, a method within a race jurisprudence is about preaching to the unconverted and developing a capacity both to draw on objective evidence and to persuade those not already persuaded of what one oneself sees. What I identified is that I believe that it really is a key element of a race jurisprudence to think about it in terms of its transparency. And what I meant there is the degree to which the jurisprudence openly manifests doubt and openly communicates the sense of personal struggle of the justice in the area of race. Well, you can see why that one was particularly important to me in writing about Justice Blackmun, because it was precisely the critique of his angst manifestation that so bothered the Blackmun clerks about his earlier race cases. I, in turn, contrarian that I am, came to think of that as, in fact, the major strength of the justice's race jurisprudence. And I think you might be able to see, in light of some of the comments today, where I might be going with that one. So what I'd like to do is, in those terms, talk about Justice Thomas's race jurisprudence. And in saying this, I should say that I've not only read the justice's autobiography, but through numbers of NYU events, I've actually had the pleasure of interacting with him in some depth and have been able to nowhere near develop the sense of the person that his former clerks would have. But I have met the person and not just read the opinions. And it's in part for that reason that I felt I could say some of the things that I'm going to say. In any case, here I go. So in terms of the justice's voice, here, obviously, this is what we're talking about. His is the clearest voice on issues of race on the court, and the clearest voice we've had in many years on issues of race. In origins, a personal voice, although, as you'll see when I talk about transparency, does not necessarily communicate itself as a personal voice, which is I think problematic but understandable for somebody speaking in the voice of law. I think that what might most characterize that voice in its positive incarnation is its sensitivity to both the symbolic and the psychological dimensions of the Black American response to race jurisprudence and racial policy in this country. Put another way, his is a critique that one might say pays close attention to the stigmatizing effects of not, quote, unconscious racism, as white race liberals talk about it, but unconscious white paternalism as a form of racism. The problem with the voice is, as I've noted, the lack of transparency in its recognition of the difficulty of these issues as he has wrestled with them throughout his life as a person and a lawyer, and his lack of willingness, again, fully understandable given his public role, to ground what he's saying in light of his own personal experience, and also his sad inability to communicate the caring about individual African Americans in the black community that he is so disturbed that people don't understand that he has in his official judicial voice. Just anecdotally, I have to say that when people I know have had the occasion to meet the justice, they're really frustrated by the fact that they can't dislike him anymore. That, you know, a passionately caring person comes through in the encounter, and they then read the opinions and wonder where that person went. Perhaps a jurisprudence that was more full of angst and less sure of itself might be able to communicate the individual in ways that his existing jurisprudence seems not to be able to do. In the area of, hold on a second, I think I wrote myself a note. No, I didn't. Okay. In the area of the scope of his race jurisprudence, I do think that he has been insightful in some areas in recognizing the implications of general policy for issues of race. Of course, from a liberal standpoint, he hasn't been willing to do that all the time. If one contrasts his position in death penalty cases with that of Justice Blackmun, who saw racial inequalities in the administration of justice as a reason to turn abolitionist, one can see that seeing race doesn't mean that you're going to see it in a way that other people agree with. But I think that there can be no doubt that his eye for issues of race as they work through society is a sharp eye indeed. Where I think I most take issue really, let me save this one for last. I'll save the hardest one for last. When it comes to the focus of the justice's race jurisprudence, meaning his willingness to go with vision and understanding based on race, even when that comes into conflict with what might more generally be sort of standard neutral doctrinal principles. I'm not going to talk about originalism generally, but it seems to me that in the two First Amendment-laden cases that that Steve writes about, the Aryan Nation case and the Burning Cross case, these are situations in which, both in the writing of the opinion and I would suspect in the reaching of a decision, the justice really put traditional First Amendment jurisprudence of the sort that he would ordinarily sign onto quite aside. And what came across in both is a sort of historical, sort of American black experiential grasp of cross-burning and the formation of violent anti-black organizations as coercive in a way unmediated by the fanciness and platitudes of the notion of speech and viewpoint. And in that sense, it most reminds me of the approach to pornography taken by Catherine MacKinnon in some of her work, in which she rejects the notion that pornography is, quote, only words. That's the title of one of her books. And immediately, in ways that others might not see or might not agree with, grasps this kind of speech as threatening action. And that's an area where I think that the focus on race causes him to prioritize his racial vision over what might otherwise be his more general legal vision. I'm not going to go to the issue of originalism, et cetera, because I think that's already been talked about. Obviously, one's focus on issues of race will be clearest in cases in which race is most clearly implicated, but these particular cases in which, again, his sensitivity that I flagged before to what did I call it, to the symbolic and the psychological dimensions of the experience of racism, I think, cause his focus to be particularly racial as opposed to generically legal in that particular area. As to his method for recognizing racism and charges of racism and the adequacy of responses to those, he very clearly, as I've said, experiences with great immediacy the manifestations of the, quote, old racism that still exists within this society. He also is really, and I think this has been said before, on a crusade against what he sees as the new racism of liberal paternalism towards African Americans. As has been said, as is so clearly manifest in the autobiography, his suspicion of this new racism has a strong class component for which reason he sees the new racism not only in whites but in the traditional sort of light skin / upper class / urban / northern elites of the civil rights movement. In that vision of new racism where he sees it, I think that he takes what becomes the sort of fully expected contrarian response to that kind of approach to civil rights wherever he sees it. I think that when it comes to having a method that allows one to get others to see what one sees oneself, I think the fact that so many of his, in our working sense, race-conscious opinions are solo dissents gives us a sense that persuading his colleagues may not be his highest priority in this sense. He has not, in any event, been able to persuade them of his vision of the workings of the new racism in this society. Again, for understandable reasons, he may not want to dilute what is a sort of only and passionate voice in order to persuade, but that's a choice that one makes in putting sort of the individuality of voice ahead of the methodologies of persuasion that one might otherwise use on these issues. That leaves me to where I have the greatest issues with the justices' race jurisprudence, and that's with where it stands in time. The fact is, I always hate when people say the fact is, but why don't I say extensive research on the history of affirmative action in the United States, and here I'm drawing on John Scrantney's work among others, shows that affirmative action was not born as a paternalistic ideology based on the belief in the inferiority of blacks, which is the way in which I believe Justice Thomas sees affirmative action in its origins, in its defense, and in its effects. What affirmative action was a strategic response to the need to move very quickly in the face of social instability, namely riots that were the pervasive voice of the northern black response to inequality in all spheres of life. There are other origins that have to do with the Nixon administration and, you know, sort of looking for strategic shifts of the white working class away from the Democratic Party. But I'm going to leave that aside because that's less relevant to what I'm saying now. But affirmative action was not merely symbolic and psychological, which are, as I've said, the strengths of Justice Thomas's orientation towards a jurisprudence of race. It was also strategic, policy-oriented, a pragmatic compromise, one based on, since Professor Bell is in the room, I will acknowledge him and say one based on interest convergence rather than on purity of ideological belief. And as the issue of affirmative action worked its way through the courts on numerous occasions, with Justice O'Connor's opinion in Grutter being a particularly clear example, the use of affirmative action was always tied to a sense that affirmative action was a second best way of achieving what one hoped a purely colorblind anti-discrimination law could achieve, but with the knowledge that that colorblind anti-discrimination law would work extremely slowly, more slowly than the societal tolerance for social unrest could really permit. And it's here that I sort of most wish that Justice Thomas would sort of both listen and teach on the issue of race. It's quite interesting that in his time at the EEOC, Justice Thomas was very much an individualist. His policy preference was towards orienting the resources of the agency to individual, what I'll call old-fashioned discrimination claims. And the critique of his doing so was, again, a question of time. Certainly there is merit to bringing those kinds of cases. Certainly they are the most consensual kinds of anti-discrimination cases, but they're not the cases that are going to get effects quickly or make the most of the limited resources of the agency. And with a sense of time comes a sense of the need for strategy. And I'll just close by saying that however pure and individual the justice is, passionate voice on questions of race is, as psychologically sophisticated as his understanding of the effect of race consciousness on the black individual might be, I think that where his jurisprudence has been lacking is in straightforwardness about how long it would really take to reach the results that society is looking to reach for African Americans if one were to follow the purely colorblind and the purely individualist kind of approaches that he seems to prefer. You know, he rightly understands affirmative action as it is usually practiced as a kind of cherry picking. You know, and I've written about this. I actually write on race, class, and affirmative action, and so I won't elaborate. And you know, he does have very good turns of phrase. And you know, when he talks about sort of aesthetic liberalism, he really is talking about the fact that if you use Band-Aid approaches, you're just hiding the nature of the problem. And this is the problem faced by anyone who has a diagnosis of a major social problem. You know, are you going to be the revolutionary who's going to strip off the Band-Aids and wait for social revolt, which is what it's always taken in this society, to really set things right? Or are you going to sort of be sort of more accommodating to sort of the needs of the everyday by using the Band-Aids, but at the same time identifying them as such? The concern that I have is that although, you know, certainly school vouchers are important things to think about, you really have to go back to a Booker T. Washington approach rather than a Malcolm X approach, I think, to think that the kinds of change that will be necessary can be accomplished without an activist state. And that's an area in which I think the racial vision and the broader libertarian vision may not in any pragmatic sense line up.
It's a great point, but there's the constitutional question and the policy question. And the constitutional question, I guess that the time question would be relevant in terms of narrow tailoring. So Justice O'Connor says we won't need affirmative action in 25 years. And Thurgood Marshall, apparently at Bakke, said it will be necessary for 100 years, which shocked Justice Powell. And maybe if you believe, Thomas is more likely to believe that it's that Marshall rather than O'Connor was right, that might affect your thoughts about whether or not affirmative action is an hourly tailored remedy, or whether more direct proposal would be better. It would be nice if you phrased that concern in constitutional terms. It might strengthen the analysis. On the policy question, I mean, I find there's a lot that's appealing about his recognition that only through investment in K-12 without shortcuts can you actually improve performance, as leading scholars of the subject has noted. But it's the part that I find jarring in the memoir, and I'm not able to quite make sense of, is that the anti-elitism is hard to reconcile for me with the degree to which he's relied on elite institutions throughout his career for his success. I mean, to see a Supreme Court justice raging against his law school classmates for their elites, and this is the fact that he's been a senior member of these elites for a long time. And the institutions that fostered his career, setting aside the question of the degree to which he benefited from affirmative action personally, are those which he seems to have contempt for. So saying that Michigan and public institutions don't need elite universities because they're not necessary engines of social progress seems to be very difficult both to reconcile with his own experience and my sense of the more conventional thought is that you want to focus on K-12 to raise academic performance so that African Americans can actually succeed. It's a great point, but there's a constitutional
I disagree with some of what you just said. Can I be feisty?
Sure.
Okay, I'll be feisty.
More the better.
Okay. You know, I've read the book too. And, you know, it seems to me that, first of all, I'm all over hating Yale, but let's leave that aside. No, that's okay. It's the predominance of Yale in legal academia. Having merely gone to Chicago, I have also suffered the stigma of my lower class upbringing. But I think that, you know, he credits Holy Cross, am I right? Not Yale. And the jobs that he was able to get after Yale are not the kinds of jobs that Yale values. You know, Yaleys don't go in-house into Midwestern corporations. And, you know, his mentorship really, you know, was most clearly a positive experience in working for a moderate Republican senator, working for Danforth. And I don't believe, I mean, the extent to which Yale might have helped him has to be weighed against the extent to which Yale, you know, sort of wrecked his self-confidence. So, you know, these things again are psychologically complex.
But he got the Danforth job because of the Yale alumni. They were the ones who sent him over there. And he got the EEOC job because of Danforth. So the point is not that he benefited from affirmative action, but he benefited from the same elite alumni network that many of the others benefited from. And I'm just trying to think how exactly he thinks that other people could follow his footsteps without access to elite.
I actually noticed there's a microphone there, so since we have a student who's standing at the microphone, I'll definitely honor your proper use of the form. Anybody else who wants to ask a question, why don't you get in line so we know how many questions there are, and go ahead.
Help with that issue.
Thank you. So I have a couple of questions and comments related to those. I guess the first, deals with Professor Malamud's comment about, you know, Justice Thomas's jurisprudence as kind of a critique of liberal paternalism. And I'm wondering if you could talk about how that may be somewhat inherent in the structure of the law because, you know, remedy flows from harm. And if you go back to Brown and just, you know, the need to demonstrate, you know, the harm of segregation, and, you know, footnote 11 of Brown, of course, you know dealt with that issue.
With the focus on harm, you know, what is often ignored is the inner resilience of black communities in dealing with segregation and, you know, the institutions and practices that they develop to cope sometimes very well with racism and with segregation. And, you know, I guess the focus, the fact that the law has to focus on harm in order to gain a remedy detracts or may cause us to ignore the inner resilience of black communities. And that's going to create a sort of black nationalist reaction, in addition to the Southern white racist reaction to desegregation. And perhaps, you know, Thomas as kind of a confluence of those two reactions, his jurisprudence coming out of those two different trends, which, you know, you would think to be opposed to each other, but in this case, you know, both reacting against the breakdown of black institutions in light of desegregation. My second question deals with, I guess, Thomas's focus in Dawson and in Virginia v. Black on, I guess, the most egregious explicit forms of racism, the cross-burning, the Aryan Brotherhood. And I'm wondering, you know, if in those opinions, you know, he's willing to kind of take a stand by himself on those issues, you know, where are his views on, I guess, more subtle forms of racism, more unconscious biases? Because he seems to attribute, you know, continued achievement gaps and educational inequities, continued racial inequities, to policies like affirmative action, rather than to subtle institutional practices, which may also be the vestiges of racism, while he does acknowledge the most egregious forms of racism in his jurisprudence.
He's certainly not someone who's very interested in rooting out unconscious biases. And I think the power of his vision, which relates to your first comment, is he believes that segregation is wrong regardless of its effect on beneficiaries, and even regardless of whether its motive is benign or not. He says the harm is racial classification, and Brown shouldn't have focused on the effects on black people, because even if they haven't been harmed, the classification itself, the discrimination itself, would have been unconstitutional. There's a powerful simplicity to that argument. Again, what strikes me is how impossible that is to locate not only in the original understanding of the Constitution, which wasn't focused on racial classifications, but on such categories of rights, and also in previous precedent. I mean, not even Korematsu said that the effects don't matter and the classifications for their own sake were wrong. So it's the radicalism of it can only be explained to me by biography, and this sense that he was so personally victimized by the generalization that came from classification, that even though slavery is not the same as affirmative action, the stigmatic effects in both cases could be similar, and therefore prudentially we have to ban both. But that just, again, seems to be an argument that is hard to look at in a textual history.
My honor off on to Vinay's questions. I have to get a little bit doctrinal. I don't think that Justice Thomas, if you asked him, would deny the existence of unconscious racism. He lives in America too. He has, my former student Angela Onwachi sort of identifies this as, he has the black conservatives' distaste for black victimology. And if unconscious racism is everywhere, and you're always going to feel burdened by it, then you simply can't function. It's its pervasiveness that makes you have to ignore it. But the other problem is that there's a connection sort of doctrinally and in a sort of industrial experience between the kinds of mechanisms that employment discrimination law uses to provide remedies for the effects of unconscious racism and the use of affirmative action as a way for employers, et cetera, to preempt the bringing of those lawsuits. So, when a conservative justice signs on to an opinion, say, shifting the burden of persuasion away from employers in disparate impact cases, it's not necessarily because they don't believe in discrimination. It's because they know that being unable to meet that burden of persuasion is causing affirmative action to become the standard practice. So,
At the microphone?
Yeah. I'm just sort of curious in what sense you think Justice Thomas had sort of an end vision for black society, because one of the criticisms that Professor Malamud made, or possible criticisms of Justice Thomas, would be that in some sense he doesn't have the appropriate angst in his writing. And so I just want to distinguish between, there's the angst in text, which may be, oh, Justice Blackmun, I'm having trouble getting through these issues, but ultimately I'm the decision maker here. And then I think maybe in Justice Thomas there's more of a profound sense of angst, which is more structural, which is, I can't make this decision. You know, he sees these other people. I'm here, but for the grace of God, I'd be there. And, you know, it's not my place, it's not our place as justices to maybe sort of make these rules for other sort of cultures and nations and that sort of thing. So I'm just curious if you think he has an end vision for black society, or if he thinks that's sort of a hands-off. Even I, as Justice Thomas, don't necessarily understand what they're going through. So that kind of minimalism.
Why don't you go ahead? You look like you have something productive to say.
I think he's so divided on all of these questions.
Yeah.
So you suggest he opposes black victimology, as he does. He never has a memoir. Every chapter sees with his inability not to cast himself as a victim. There's not a slight that he can't get over. He is still lamenting the indignities of Pinpoint. He criticizes civil rights leaders for moaning and complaining, but he himself seems to fall into the same track. And you say, on the one hand, he doesn't think judges should second guess his questions and leave up to society. On the other, this is the point of this panel, his affirmative action jurisprudence is one of the most aggressive examples of using the courts to impose his own vision of good social policy on a divided nation. I mean, he has a very contested vision, which he wants to enact by judicial fiat. It's shared by some, but not most African Americans, that he, in a kind of meliorous way, thinks that the courts can actually improve race relations. Is he an optimist in the long run? Where does he think it's going? This is not an optimistic man about race. He's just couldn't be more concerned about the pervasiveness of racism and the difficulty of overcoming it. I do wonder, I don't know if my colleagues have any thoughts on this, I asked Rick whether he thought what he thought Thomas thought about Obama. And he may or may not want to share an anecdote, but that to me would cast more light on his thoughts about the future of race than anything else.
Unless you want to use that anecdote.
Well, there's one thing that I'll say that I think Deborah has kind of suggested, but I want to make sure it kind of comes out in the discussion. My sense, mostly from conversations with him, not that it's in the jurisprudence directly, is that it's a mistake, as Deborah said, to read Thomas as having this sort of blissful view about the problems of race and racism have gone away, and you know, his hostility to affirmative action or projects like that is a product of that kind of vision of American society today. It's much more that his view is that the cultivation of these various qualities in particularly African-American kids coming up, the emphasis on the discipline, the self-reliance, the back to the basics, all the things that Nicole was talking about, is in part precisely because he sees all of that out there. And that he thinks that that it's important to inculcate not a focus on these barriers, but a focus on developing, you know, the kind of personal capital and these skills that will enable people to achieve as much as they can despite these sorts of circumstances. And I think that that's something that's almost never really appreciated about how those pieces of his view come together. It's kind of not these problems don't exist, but a sort of a second order view that people should be encouraged to act and behave as if they don't, because the alternative is to consign them to a much worse fate. I have not talked to the justice since President Obama's election, and I did notice a picture when the president was at the court with Justice Thomas smiling, very, very big smile in Obama's presence. Now, he actually laughs a lot. He's a very warm, expressive kind of person, despite the silence on the bench, which is so contrary to that image. So I don't know how much to read into that. But I do know from conversations before the election, and I'll say at least this much about the anecdote that Jeff was referring to. I think he was certainly intrigued to see what was going on with Obama and the Obama campaign. The court has a major case before it in April on the constitutionality of recent reauthorizations to a portion of the Voting Rights Act. And I would be shocked if the name President Obama does not come up in that argument, and how his election factors into the discussion, as well as the fact that the Republican Party is now headed by an African American who was chosen as the party leader, Michael Steele. You know, it would be very interesting to see whether the justice actually comments at the argument about those kinds of issues. So, Deborah, do you want to speak, or should we take more questions?
Let me just say one thing about this. In thinking about the sort of policy wonk continuum, if you have Justice Breyer on one end of that, Justice Thomas is surely on the other. I don't think that he has a policy vision that is technocratic, incremental, that sort of takes you from one place to another clearly envisioned place. I think that in that sense, he's quite modest. I also think, and maybe this goes to his originalism to a certain extent, it might be in the face of that modesty, and also in the face of his anti-elitism, that he is drawn to simplicity. Simplicity of values, simplicity the development of simple in the sense of not overly decorated, kind of approach, so that originalism or color blindness or those kinds of formulations, things that a person not trained in the law could understand, seem to be particularly attractive to him. I don't think, again, that those are paired with any kind of vision of how they're going to work.
I think there's one sort of substantive orientation that we haven't talked about too directly. I'm sorry for postponing your question, but I think this might be worth raising for people, especially for this journal and this conference. In his office, some of the portraits that he has include Frederick Douglass, Ronald Reagan, Margaret Thatcher. I can't remember if there's a Lincoln one, but at least those. And I remember sort of thinking, well, what unites these, or what does he think unites these? And I always had the instinct that it's actually a certain conception of freedom, that that's how he thinks about this, that a lot of what he envisions is removing the state in various ways. I mean, I think that is part of something that Tim Standifer was getting at in his comments, that there is a certain kind of libertarian side that, like the line from Frederick Douglass, just get the state off our backs. Don't help us. The state becomes captured by one set of interests or another. That's maybe the Jacksonian side that I thought was so interesting for Jeff to emphasize. You know, once you bring the state into all sorts of activities, the elites will get control, or this faction will get control, or that's where the problem comes. And so I don't know if that's right in interpreting this sequence of portraits, but if you're looking for an overall kind of vision and what the aspiration is, it would not surprise me if that's an important place to locate it. Now, whether that's realistic, whether that kind of freedom can be achieved without a robust role for the state, I mean, those are obviously the kinds of questions that people debate in talking about the role of government. But I think that's a very powerful element in the way in which Thomas perceives American history and his own substantive values. Anyway, I left. Where's our student or a person who was?
Thank you. Thanks. I'm not a legal scholar myself, but I'm interested in what your perspective would be on his practice as a jurist. In practical terms, it seems that he does enjoy the role of being an individualist and a maverick, but that can impair perhaps his ability to be persuasive, both in present terms and perhaps in the long term. As a jurist, does he immediately seem to seek that role as the maverick or the outlier or the dissenter, or has the experience been, do you think, that this is a product of extensive debate? Do you think his natural inclination is to strike out on his own, or has he been? We don't know too much because he's been so reticent in oral discussions, in oral argument. But what is your intuition of what happens when the nine are just gathered together? Is he typically one, do you think, who speaks and tries to persuade his colleagues, or do you see that he wants to forge his own path, and maybe the purpose behind that is to kind of seed jurisprudential history so that these dissenting opinions will somehow be cited in decades that follow?
He certainly tries to persuade, and a relevant example of this might be the conference before the Abernathy case, when the justices went around the table, Thomas said, I'm the only one sitting at this table who ever attended a segregated school. And he described what the effect was, and he said the wrong of segregation wasn't that it was all black, but that it was state imposed. Jan Greenberg has a book out arguing that Thomas has been misunderstood as a persuader. Actually, he's far more persuasive than people give him credit for, and she cites one or two cases where he staked out a rather dramatic position and the court came around to his side. My sense is that although that's a useful corrective to the wrong stereotypes of him as being disengaged, he persuades less frequently than he dissents. And ultimately, he's more of a devoted to ideology, is the uncharitable word. He's devoted to principle rather than to pragmatism. And it was someone like him, Chief Justice Roberts had in mind when he complained that some of his colleagues, Roberts' colleagues, were acting more like law professors than members of the collegial court and were not really interested in compromising in the interests of collegiality. So, in short, happy to get a court when he can, but also perfectly happy to be in dissent and relishes that role.
Okay, I'm getting signals from our leader, Dan, that it's time to bring this to a close. Thank you to the journal. Thank you to Dan for conceiving of this and the journal members who helped conceive it and all of you who helped with the logistics. Thank you to the people who traveled to get here in these conditions. I've never had gotten the opportunity to play three different roles at one conference, so I enjoyed that. But thank you to all of you who have stayed. And I think that when this issue comes out, it will be really very, very significant in generating much more attention to what's unique and distinctive about Justice Thomas's views. I think that's a tremendous achievement for the journal, especially for one that's only 5 years old. And I've enjoyed the day, so thank you and thank our panelists.
Covered most of the thanks for me, but I really need to thank Professor Pildes for all the advice he's given us, and this day probably wouldn't have happened if he hadn't been able to step in two places. I also thank Professor Malamud for stepping in at the last minute. I'll echo the thanks to all the people who wrote for today, Professor Maggs, Professor Garnett, Professor Smith. Their articles will appear in the Journal of Law and Liberty, Volume 4, Issue 3, which will be released May or June this summer. So look for that, and you can go to our website. We have a few copies of the journal. Please sign our email list if you'd like to receive emails about programs we're putting on. That's the only thanks I have. So I just want to, again, thank everyone. It was an excellent program.